first of two. Where's Higgins, but a sophomore, and here's his second score, driving right through that BYU defense. And he has kept Tulsa's chances very much alive going into the final 15 minutes. BYU will look at second down and three as we begin the final quarter. McKenzie diving close to first down yardage, appears to be a little bit shy. Here's the Delta Airlines game summary after three quarters.
What an impressive total offensive output for both teams. I mean, look at this, 414, 329 yards on the left. That is what these teams would love to have in a game, not just three quarters of play. Very impressive offensive performances here in the first three quarters of play.
Third down and a yard to go. Jared Kennedy is the man in motion. McKenzie fighting for what appears to be first down yardage.
When he didn't get that one by much, was a last second spin that I think gets Brian McKenzie the first down yardage. He sees a whole backside, makes the cutback, plays off the tackle, and that spin is what's going to get him the first down as he bounces off Rich Young.
Well, BYU has won six straight WAC home games. Looking to stretch that streak to seven. They've been in quite a battle. Speaking of stretch, those guys are stretching on the sideline. They've been in a battle today. Here's that inside screen to Hooks. And Margin Hooks has 10 yards. Rich Young tackled him.
First down.
Take a look. What they're going to do again is bring these guys out here to block. Margin Hooks comes across, and I want you to watch as Joe Long comes out, number 70. You can't see him on the screen now, but the left guard's going to come out and make a nice block upfield for Margin Hooks. Right here is Joe Long. Hard to get him while he's moving. He makes a very nice block for Margin Hooks up the field, allows him to get that first down yardage.
Frederick burns a timeout. That's the Cougars' first timeout that they've used in the second half. Tulsa's used one earlier.
And Frederick was just out of time on the 25-second play clock. Down to 2 seconds and had to take the timeout to avoid the 5-yard delay penalty.
Well, it's funny, you know, Holly mentioned earlier that the defense a little irritated a week ago at BYU because the offense wasn't getting the job done. I wonder what the emotions are on the sideline right now, where BYU's in an absolute shootout, the offense scoring almost at will, and the defense can't stop Tulsa.
You know, and that happens over the course of a season, and that's why you can't have the offense or defense get on one another, because there are going to be games that the offense is going to win and some that the defense are going to win.
We'll come back in a moment. BYU leading by 9 early in the fourth quarter. This is the Blue and White Sports Network. Provo, Utah, Cougar Stadium, better than 64,000 looking on. BYU leading by 42-33. Frederick standing tall in the pocket for Cahoon. Trying to work against the double team coverage. Kevin Frederick remains down. And that is an ominous sight. Ball documented the problems of Kevin with the ankle. It does not appear, though, that is what they're working on. They're looking at Kevin. Let's go down to Holly Rowe.
Kevin did get hit hard in the head. It looks like it was a chin blow. But right now we're talking with Steve Sarkisian, a guy that I have emails every day. What happened to Steve Sarkisian, one of the BYU's favorite sons? How you doing?
I'm doing very good. I got married this past summer, and that's been the greatest thing for me, you know, in a long time. But I went up to Canada and went through that season there. It was okay, but I think it's time to move on.
You went to the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and now you're moving on to the World Football League and maybe do some things overseas this summer.
Yeah, I'd love to do that. I think it'd be a good opportunity for me to go over there and get some snaps and some playing time, and then hopefully get in an NFL camp next year.
Okay, thanks for joining us, Steve Sarkisian.
Of course, Steve had a brilliant career leading the Cougars to that 14-1 record last year, winning the Cotton Bowl championship. As we take a look at the collision and how Federick was shaken up.
And Federick's going to take a, boy, just a vicious, vicious hit that time from Sean O'Boyle coming from his defensive end position. Very physical. It was head-on face mask. And that had to ring Kevin Federick's bell a little bit on that play. Tried to force the ball in a little bit that time. He had Ben Cahoon on a post route. That time the free safety was in the middle of the field. Levi Gillen was there to make the play. And Federick paid the price of standing in there, throwing a ball in the face of a big rush.
Well, we all know how tough Kevin Federick is. You're looking at a man that had his ankle fractured on October 11th, and he's still been able to put up those numbers. But he, too, has a bloody chin. We saw that from Paul Shoemaker a few weeks ago. How physical is it for these quarterbacks these days as Drew Miller comes on?
You know, I believe that they're not protecting him enough. They really protect the quarterbacks in the National Football League, but these college quarterbacks take shots late all game long. It's rare for a quarterback to see a deep ball completed in college football today because they take a hit on almost every play.
Defenses are also sophisticated, too. It's tough to protect your quarterback at all times. Miller handing to McKenzie, running wide and has no chance. Ball is loose. Adonis Peel picks it up and takes it in, but it's blown dead. Cougars will get a break.
Take a look as McKenzie's trying to get to the outside. You're going to see the face mask right there. McKenzie's brought down by the face mask.
Face mask on the defense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Well, Kevin Federick was shaken up. Let's go down to the sideline and Holly for an update.
I talked to the team doctor as he was leading Kevin up the tunnel. He said it is just a cut on his chin. Kevin looked like he recognized where he was. He didn't have a glazed overlook, so it looks like they will just be putting some stitches in his chin and he will be back.
Well, I guess that's good news, although you can't tell Kevin that right now. I'm sure he's not feeling really good. He'd like to get back in there. But when he first went down, the first thing that flashed in my mind was, I hope it's not the ankle.
And they immediately started to work on his upper body, and I think there was a sigh of relief everywhere in the stadium.
Second down and six. After the face mask, Drew Miller with good protection. And his receiver fell down. It was Margin Hooks. Margin Hooks saying he was tripped.
When Margin Hooks was beginning to open up on a post route, and just before the ball was thrown, he was hit and knocked to the ground. And he wants a call, but it looks like feet just got tangled up and he went down. Kevin Federick, just a few minutes ago, heading out the tunnel to go get medical attention in the locker room he needs for that chin.
Well, Pavel Edwards thought he'd get Drew Miller in early in this game. It was 21-0. They had Miller warming up on the sideline, but Tulsa's made quite a game of it. Now Miller forced into action with Federick going out. Third down and six. Aaron Cup with a fine catch, but short of the necessary yardage. Rashawn Farley, outstanding freshman, making the tackle for Tulsa. At the conclusion of the game, watch for the rock-solid play of the game. Sponsored by Prudential Real Estate, with offices in Orem, Salt Lake, Bountiful, Park City, Heber, Layton, Roy, and Ogden. Well, 15 left in the game, Tulsa. Back by but nine. Hartsfield's had one punt block today. Resulted in a safety. And the Golden Hurricane will have it right about their 24. The way Tulsa's been moving the football, they're very much a part of this one. John Fitzgerald's come up big so far in this contest for Tulsa. His counterpart, Federer, took quite a hit earlier in this quarter. John O'Boyle's had a terrific game for Tulsa today. Defensive end. He was there. He and Neil Whitworth leveled Kevin Federick and sent him out of the ball game. Here's John Fitzgerald taking over at the Tulsa 23. Sending Brister in motion. Throwing that one away, intended for Gerald Smith.
Fitzgerald sent Brister in motion to the left side, and then he had him run a hitch route. He wanted to go out there. And Tyler Nelson, as he came in motion, jumped out and double-teamed Brister, and there was no place to go with the football.
Well, it seems like weeks ago, Michael Wall started at quarterback today for Tulsa. Couldn't move his team. Fitzgerald's come in and rallied the troops. 42-33, BYU, 11:56 left. Tip, and Lippe, the tight end, has it. Out to the 45-yard line. Well, BYU's had a lot of fortunate bounces today on some balls they put on the ground and recovered. Tulsa will say, it's about time we got one.
But you saw the smile on Fitzgerald's face because he realizes he got away with one here. He threw it into traffic, into his own coverage. And Lippe was just the beneficiary of a lucky tip. And he goes, all right, this is great. And he was smiling all the way, realizing that he threw it into coverage and got away with it for a 22-yard gain.
Once in a while, you'll see a ball deflected and caught. There was two deflections before it was caught. Well, finally, BYU jams up the dive play. Kevin Isham has had great success on that first back through dive effort. For one of the rare times today, BYU closes it off.
Chris Hoken at the defensive tackle now. He closed that dive lane down very quickly. You're right, that's the first time BYU stopped that this afternoon.
Dave Rader went to Rogers High School, right down the street from the University of Tulsa, born and raised. Coaching his alma mater. Play fake. This one's tipped and caught. And Savage has a first down. Well, BYU's getting their hands on the ball. This time it was Spencer Reed. He deflected it, and Savage brought it in.
Just a play action fake this time by Fitzgerald. Looking upfield, and again, the ball a little bit underthrown. And it goes right through the hands of Rob Morris and into the hands of Damon Savage. So another fortunate play for Tulsa, but good concentration by Damon Savage. As you look at his numbers, 4 receptions and 69 yards. Great concentration to still bring that one in after it went through the hands of Morris.
Play clock down near zero, so Tulsa has to call the timeout. They burn their second one, only one remaining for the Golden Hurricane. Ken Schmidt, the BYU defensive coordinator, wanting his team to regroup. Tulsa moving the ball. This is the Blue and White Sports Network. Golden Hurricane at the Cougar 36, down by 9. Fitzgerald running out of bounds.
Fitzgerald keeps the ball.
Gain of 3. This game is brought to you in part by Maverick Country Store and Bakery, where low prices on high quality gas means your car can't tell the difference, but your wallet sure can. This has been a game for the quarterbacks. Kevin Federick has been great for BYU, and John Fitzgerald has been amazing coming off the bench, showing a great capacity to lead his team downfield. Yeah, he's a guy that threw for 357 yards last year in the big win over Iowa. Going back over the middle. Brought it as tight end Lippe. It'll be 3rd and 7.
You're going to see Lippe try to go down the middle of the field, but Jason Walker is in good position, and this is what they don't like Fitzgerald to do. This is why the 8 interceptions on the year. He's going to force the ball, and he gets a little bit of pressure. The ball should not be thrown, and look at him throw into double coverage. He's very fortunate that Walker doesn't intercept that ball.
Holding. On the offense, 10-yard penalty. Spot of the foul. Repeat second down.
Well, that'll back up the Golden Hurricane. See that Fitzgerald is squinting as the sun has come back out.
turned into a gorgeous after, you know, fall afternoon here in Provo, which started out as kind of a drizzly, overcast day.
Golden Hurricane looking at second and 23. Still plenty of time for the visitors. Too far for Savage. Good coverage in the secondary from Walker and Morgan. And that's as loud as it's been at Cougar Stadium today. Fans nowadays get more excited for the defense than the offense, it seems. There's Ken Schmidt, BYU defensive coordinator. Feels very comfortable with his team. Feels like they've had a terrific year, although today it's been very difficult to stop Tulsa. Third and very long for Fitzgerald. Needs to reach the Brigham Young 26 for the first down. Threw that one behind his receiver who was open. Brister. One of the rare misses by Fitzgerald today.
Going to try to go to Brister. Brister's going to go up the field in a crossing route and come back on the post. And you see that Jack Williams loses track of where Brister is on that crossing route. He was open, and Fitzgerald not able to deliver the football in the proper place. Brister can't come up with a great catch thrown behind him.
Jaron Dabney averaging better than 10 yards per punt return this year. Fitzgerald angling this one to the corner. Not a good punt. Again, he's keeping it away from Jaron Dabney. Line it up at the 20-yard line. Well, you see Federick strapping the helmet on, so let's find out more about Kevin Federick from Holly Row.
Kevin went into the locker room. He had six stitches in his chin, but he does not have a concussion, so he is definitely clear to play.
Well, no one can deny the competitive spirit of Kevin Federick. Ankle, chin, doesn't matter, he's in there. McKenzie straight ahead. McKenzie deep into the secondary, across the 35-yard line. A 17-yard run by Brian McKenzie. Levi Gillen, senior, three-year starter out of the deep secondary, made the tackle.
Just a quick cross between the center and the two guards on the inside. And watch at the end of this run, McKenzie going to get up limping a little bit, watches his leg kind of extends out in front of him as his foot slips out on the turf, and he got up and was walking a little gingerly, and you see him with a slight limp as he jogs off the field right now.
Jaron Dabney in the backfield as a running back with Kennedy in motion. And it is Dabney taking the handoff. Up to the 46, that's a 9-yard gain for Dabney. And he gets to the hole in a hurry. Tackled by Jeremy McClure, sophomore linebacker.
What makes Dabney so effective from that tailback position is how quickly he can get to the hole. You don't have to block for very long when Dabney's in the backfield. Just get in the way for a second, and he's on the linebackers and in the secondary.
Second down and one. His touchdown was 18 yards on a reverse. Snowden sliding outside, and Will Snowden showing the will. Levi Gillen. Another tackle. Again, Gillen's a guy that had 102 tackles last year, and coming in at 125 takedowns, number 25 in the deep secondary.
Just a tremendous seam created. See a nice block there by Ben Cahoon to pick off a man for Snowden. Gillen finally makes the tackle. They've not said Gillen's name a lot in this football game. And this is a guy that's been making almost 16 tackles a game, 125 coming in, and has not been as active in this football game as he has been previous to this game during the season.
Yeah, he's the leading tackler in the WAC. Here's McKenzie. Brian McKenzie is gone. For Brian McKenzie, his longest touchdown gallop of the year. Earlier, he had a 40-yard scamper for a touchdown at Rice.
Well, and rarely do you get to see McKenzie out in the open field this year, but he shows you when he's out there, he can really accelerate. 4.28 yard, 40-yard dash this year for the pro scouts, and he showed you that on that run.
Well, BYU's total at 48, the most this season, and they've needed the points today ahead of Tulsa 48-33. Brian McKenzie well over 100 yards rushing again today against Tulsa, 2 years in a row. BYU increases its lead to 16 as we flash back to McKenzie's touchdown run.
And it's just a quick trap inside. You're going to bring Cox to the right guard. Kick out the tackle. McKenzie cuts it up through the hole and back to the right side. Now this is when you just see all speed. He can fly up the field and easily outruns Wade Clark for the touchdown. And there's the reaction of the quarterback, Kevin Federick, for the touchdown.
Well, Brian McKenzie unofficially has 175 yards on the ground. College, our statistician tells us, and that's a lot of push-ups on the sideline. But 175 yards for Brian McKenzie, a tremendous effort. Of course, when you break the big one, the 44-yard score, that always enhances the stats, but he's come up big. Again, Tavian Banks of Iowa ran for 314 yards against Tulsa, so it's not a great surprise that it would be a breakout game for McKenzie.
Banks was just unbelievable in that football game. McKenzie's been very good here. Four plays, 80 yards, 1 minute and 44 seconds. That 44-yard run by Brian McKenzie.
Well, Potchman kicking off. Mason Jacoby, number 27, waiting. Potchman able to drive this one too deep for Jacoby to return. Well, it's interesting. You go around the country and in recent weeks, people were thinking, are these BYU scores misprints? So now everyone's accustomed to like 14-3, 13-10. They're going to see this score tomorrow and say, wait a minute, is this a misprint? It's too high.
They'll think that this is more of the WAC scores that they're used to seeing. The WAC scoring's been down this year. But not in this football game. There's McKenzie, 21 rushes, 175 yards, 8.3 yard average. He's now in sixth place on the career rushing list. He'd passed both Eldon Fortuy and Fred Whittingham on BYU's all-time rushing list with his effort this afternoon.
This will be the eighth consecutive game that McKenzie has led the Cougars in rushing. And Fitzgerald one more time trying to rally his team. This one is a ball that flutters out there, but Savage able to bring it in. Looked like one of those passes thrown by the old-timer Joe Kapp when he was with the Vikings. They always seem to flutter out there.
Well, it didn't have to be that great a throw because Savage made a great move on Omar Morgan. He went up the field like he was going on a streak, got Omar Morgan to turn his hips, and then came back on the comeback. Watch the hit that Fitzgerald takes. We talked about protecting the quarterbacks. These guys take hits, it seems like, on every throw.
And Higgins takes quite a hit here, stormed under. Byron Frisch, 93. First one to bring down Mr. Higgins. Well, Charlie Higgins is a solid running back. Tulsa obviously has the formula for success in the future offensively. They'll need to retool their defense if they're going to be a factor in years to come in the WAC. But good numbers for Fitzgerald in relief. And you have to like his moxie coming in, showcasing his leadership, bringing his team back when it was 21-0. So 7:25 left in the game. Allen knocked away. Nice effort by Cook on a ball intended to Gerald Smith. And it'll be third down and 12 for Tulsa.
The one thing that's been impressive about this Tulsa offense is that their skill people are very young. This is a good offense that's going to get better in the next couple of years. A lot of sophomores and freshmen playing. Excellent coverage on Gerald Smith, one of those sophomores by Ben Cook. Trying to run that underneath route.
Well, you're not going to win many games when you're 0-10. Despite that, they have 33 points on the board. Wide open again. And Savage doing a nice dance in the secondary. Damon Savage to the 10, to the 5, to the 1 yard line. And now it's indicated touchdown. One official had him going out at the 1, but they gave him the score. 65 yards, and Tulsa comes back again.
Boy, and that's a way to convert a third down. They haven't converted one all day, 0-10. They'll take that 1-for-11 if the 1 is a 65-yard touchdown pass. Savage put on a great move after he caught the football on Jack Williams to freeze him. Goes up the side. The official that should have made the touchdown call got knocked down on the play.
Well, Damon Savage came in with 49 receptions. He's a guy that caught 9 balls for 151 yards against Rice. You see that 151? He's duplicated it. Now the direct snap to Isham, and he fails on the two-point try. So it remains a 10-point game. 49-39. Keep in mind, 2 years ago here, it was 45-35 out of that swinging gate.
And Tulsa, when they do their extra point, they line up over to the left and then slide in if they're going to kick it. That time they just had the center snap it sideways. Let's look at that touchdown again. BYU tries to go with a blitz and play man coverage. That allows Savage to have the middle of the field. And look at the move he puts on Walker. Then another move on Jack Williams to get him to the sideline. And then it's just a race to the end zone for Damon Savage. What a performance by Savage here this afternoon. There's the action from John Fitzgerald. Made a nice read on the play. Recognized the blitz. Got the ball down the middle of the field.
Sideline. Let's go to Holly Rowe.
Guys, you'll remember in the first half, Savage was going one-on-one with Omar Morgan, but BYU's defensive secondary has changed things up here in the second half. They've gone with more zone coverage, and that time you saw Omar wasn't on Damon Savage. That's one of the reasons Tulsa is breaking a lot of long balls here in the second half. The defensive secondary switching things up and maybe not getting a good handle on what's happening with the Tulsa passing game.
Might be a good idea to get Omar back on Savage.
I'd say so.
Well, Damon Savage, just a sophomore. Glenn, you touched upon it. These skill position players, Smith and Savage, just sophomores. Higgins, a sophomore. Anderson kicking off and through the end zone. Still 7:08 remaining. BYU has scored 149 points in just less than 3 games against Tulsa, and they've had to fight for every win each year. It's never been easy. Here's Kevin Federick, the 4 touchdown throws, the high water mark in his career.
Good percentage there also with a 14 of 26.
McKenzie, who just scored, tries it again. That big offensive line now working against a much lighter defense. Starting to push Tulsa around. Tim Martin, offensive tackle. Turning starter for the Golden Hurricane. Drops McKenzie, but not before he was able to rush upfield for 8 yards.
Martin, one of the bigger guys on that defensive front at 274 pounds, but O'Boyle's only 261. It's interesting to say only anymore. 10 years ago, 261 was great size, but now these D linemen go anywhere from 280 to 320 pounds. So he's not a big guy. Lang at 260, and Sparks only 236. Not a big physical front for Tulsa.
McKenzie again. crossing the 30 and has the first down. Wade Clark out of the secondary snapped him. Well, 187 yards. As good as it's gotten for Brian McKenzie. And again, he is a guy we featured early today on our pregame, and we felt that he would have a huge game. Give some credit to those big guys up front. Archibald's had some impact. He's replacing the injured John Tate. John Tate figures to come back next week and play against New Mexico at Albuquerque. Of course, ideally, BYU would like to run the football here. And it's McKenzie again. Not much there, and a flag going into the pile. It's O'Boyle that stood up to play. So Rich Young also tangled up with Brian McKenzie.
McKenzie obviously not appreciating the continued play after the whistle. Take a look. The play designed to go off left tackle, and McKenzie cuts it back. O'Boyle makes a nice play, stands his ground. And the whistle's already blown. McKenzie's just trying to get loose, and Young continues to pursue. And McKenzie not too happy about that.
Defense, 5-yard penalty. First down. Remains first down.
Well, Lavelle Edwards has 233 career victories. A win today would tie him with Bo Schembechler. Legendary name from Michigan. Of course, here's a man with quite a legacy here at Brigham Young, and Lavelle Edwards, and you wonder how long he'll coach. Recently at Fresno State, Jim Sweeney Field, Bulldog Stadium, Jim Sweeney Field, and I would imagine here at Cougar Stadium, someday it'll be Lavelle Edwards Field. Here's Dabney. Jerem Dabney across the 40-yard line. Tackled by Tim Martin.
Sliding down from that defensive tackle. Some backs are gliders where they kind of pick their hole. Other backs just get after it. Dabney's a guy, there is no hesitation. He goes immediately to where the hole is supposed to be and gets upfield. And it's a changeup. As McKenzie runs sweeps, he's more of a picker and chooser, and Dabney just gets there. So it's a good changeup for BYU to be able to use him at that tailback position.
Well, this picker is doing pretty good. He's raising the roof to the tune of a very nice yardage per play. Second down at one after game nine. This time, Will Stone is closed off. Rich Young, former junior college teammate at Glendale City College in Arizona, of J.D. Hartsfield, was rapid to getting the ball. He was there in a hurry.
Young's number two on this team in tackles. Came into this game averaging just under 11. You see him read that all the way, slide from that middle linebacker position, and put the shoulder to Will Snowden. Good play by Rich Young.
Young was on the outside last year, outside linebacker, moved inside, and obviously he's produced, but he needs some help from his teammates. They've given up way too many points this year. BYU trying to run the clock out and protect the 10-point lead. Here's Dampen. Exploding to the 45-yard line, and it's a first down. Again, Young knocked him off his pins. Have to be impressed with how quickly Dabney gets to the hole.
He does, and you wonder if he can take the pounding, because he looks like he's very big, but he's actually quite stout. Weighs 170 pounds, and he's put together very well. Very strong player. You see him hit that hole with great speed. By the time you realize he's running the ball, he's already 2 yards up the field.
Something BYU has always wanted to do this year is try to find room for Dabney in the offense, and today they've been able to do it. Tulsa only has one timeout remaining. It's Snowden's turn. Will Snowden can't get to the perimeter. Wade Clark, the strong safety, coming up and supports run. Let's go to Holly once again.
Guys, it's no secret Tulsa has a good offensive team. In fact, they're sixth in the WAC in total offense. But the defense has been hit hard by injury this year. In 8 games, Tulsa has had 23 different starters on the defensive side of the ball. 5 redshirt freshmen and 1 true freshman have been in starting roles. So you've got to wonder what kind of team this Tulsa team can evolve into when these youngsters get some playing time and they can solidify their defense.
And Holly's right, and because of the playing time the young players have gotten this year, this is a team to watch over the next couple of years.
Well, their defense looks good here on Dabney. They shut him down. Rich Young. You can see why he averages 11 tackles a game. He's a rough customer.
When Young was up in a blitz position, came immediately at the snap of the ball and was unaccounted for by the BYU offense, and so he had a free shot at Dabney before he had a chance to even get going.
And of course, Tulsa fully aware of the fact that BYU looking to run the clock out. But on third down and 15, let's see if the Cougars go up top. They line up with Federick in a shotgun. 49-39, Brigham Young. This one is caught, sliding low to the ground to get the ball is Dustin Johnson. Short of the first down, it'll be fourth down, a yard and a half. Fans here exhorting their team on to go for it.
Dustin Johnson just short of that, the first down marker. Federick threw the ball a little bit behind Dustin Johnson, so he had to come back for the football and was down right where he caught it. Had he been able to catch that on the run, it would have been an easy first down.
Well, Dustin caught five against the Golden Hurricane last year when he was playing fullback, playing tight end today. Been playing tight end all afternoon long. Moving him back and forth all season between that position and the fullback spot. Senior from Eager, Arizona. Well, Tulsa has called its final timeout of the day. About 49-39 with a minute 55. Of course, if BYU runs a play and converts on fourth down, then they can just run out the clock. See if Lavelle Edwards, Norm Chow and company, that brain trust on the sideline, elect to go for it on fourth down. Nope, they're going to send Hartsfield on and punt it away. Give us an opportunity to see Tulsa's offense again.
And it hasn't taken Tulsa long to score on some of the drives today, so minute 55 certainly is plenty of time for Tulsa to get another score the way they've played offensively today.
That's our Braggs. Fields at the 15. 6-yard return to the 21. Spencer Bragg someday wants to be the Tulsa head coach. If I was Dave Ritt, I'd want him off the team. For each game, AT&T Wireless Services salutes the outstanding athlete by asking our sports team to select the AT&T Wireless Most Valuable Player. Today's AT&T MVP, undoubtedly, is Kevin Federick. Although Brian McKenzie had a great presence for the Cougars. Federick comes in, throws four touchdowns.
Boy, he played, you look at the numbers, 15 out of 27, 246 yards, the four touchdowns, and the runner-up in our minds right next to him, Brian McKenzie, with 187 yards rushing.
Omar Morgan knocks that one away from Smith at the last possible instant. I mentioned before that if I was Dave Rader, I wouldn't want Spencer Braggs on the team. Only because Spencer's desire is to become the head coach. I want to clarify that. It's not like he's a bad kid or anything.
And Morgan again with an opportunity for interception. Hasn't had an interception yet this year, but he certainly has had his opportunities to come up with a pickoff. There was another opportunity where he made a good play on the ball and just could not come up with a catch.
Second down and 10. Glenn, it's been fun working with you this season. I don't know that we're doing any more football. We're headed into the basketball campaign now. I've had a good time.
Well, it's been a marvelous season.
And Jason Walker nearly had that one on the deflection. Cougars about to go to 6-3. Still alive in the Mountain Division. And for Tulsa, they're going to lose again, and they're going to fall to 2-7. Today's game is produced by Michael Miner and directed by Russ Merrill. The technical director is Marcus Allen, and the graphics coordinators are Jessica Johnson and Brian Mangum. Executive producer for the Blue and White Sports Network, Dan Chekas. Over the middle, Spencer Reed hitting Higgins.
Pass from Fitzgerald to Higgins. This is Spencer Reed on the stop.
Lana Tilly helps us each week on our crew. It's her birthday. She didn't tell us how old she was. She looks young. They know that. Fourth down, five to go for Tulsa. This is their last gasp. Approaching a minute to go, down by 10. Incomplete. Ben Cook did a real nice job of suffocating Smith at the line of scrimmage.
Smith was trying to get on the slant, and Ben Cook didn't even let him go to the inside. Fitzgerald threw the ball out there anyhow, and no receiver to make the catch.
But some plaudits for John Fitzgerald. A gallant effort by number 16 today for Tulsa.
There's a look. You could see Ben Cook with that inside position took the slant away from Gerald Smith. Yeah, Fitzgerald had an outstanding football game. Came in and really sparked this offense for Tulsa.
That's Kevin Federick in there, in all probability to take the knee, and does. Like he tripped up over Aaron Cupp as he took the knee. And the fans are going home, and Kevin Federick, a job well done. No one expected him to be back this quickly after the fractured ankle at Rice on October 11th. Kevin Federick told people, "I can be back for Tulsa." The coaching staff was hopeful to get him back by New Mexico. He was right. He came back, and he was terrific today against the Golden Hurricane.
And Holly mentioned earlier that this is a big advantage for BYU to have Federick play a game before that New Mexico game, an opportunity to work on his game, and to be even sharper as he goes into a big showdown in New Mexico next week.
So after a disappointing loss last week at UTEP 14-3, BYU stays perfect against Tulsa, beating them for the fifth time. Well, that's all the history of this series. Five games, BYU's won them all. And all the scores recently almost identical. 49-39, the victory for Brigham Young this afternoon, and another shootout in Provo, Utah. Lavelle Edwards, his 234th career victory. And for Lavelle's squad, they go to 6-3, 4-2 in the conference. And Dave Rader's troops are 2-7 and 2-4.
Well, Randy, we talked about scoring being down this year in the WAC, and we've called some games this year that haven't had the great scoring, but this certainly is more reflective of what people are used to seeing in the Western Athletic Conference, all kinds of offense. A fun game to watch if you're a fan.
Well, Kevin Federick was great today, and he's with our Holly Rowe.
Kevin, you proved everybody wrong coming back so soon, and you had a gutsy performance despite six stitches in the chin today.
Yeah, our team came out and responded well. I just wanted to come in this week and give the team a spark. Work today, our offensive line did a heck of a job protecting me and keeping guys off me, and it was a great win.
How does the ankle feel right now?
It's fine. I took one shot on it on one play, but other than that, everything's fine, and I'm just going to get the tape off right now so and put some ice on it.
Kevin, it seems like your attitude is completely different, almost like you've taken ownership of this team and your leadership today.
That's what the quarterback's supposed to do. I've just been trying to, rally the team around. We had a tough loss last week, and I just wanted to come back on Tuesday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and, really try to spark the team and get us back on track.
Now, I know your mom came up and gave you some home cooking for like a week. You kept stretching your ankle, and you were trying to do everything you could to come back so fast.
Yeah, I did. I had the injury in my high school year, same kind of thing, and they told me to be out 6 weeks. But, I got back on that one 3 weeks, so I figured, hey, this is the same type of injury. And, my goal was to get back in 3 weeks, so that's what happened.
Tell us about the hit when you went down. You got hit from both sides.
Yeah. I mean, I've never been hit like that before. I guess that's a college football hit or something. I mean, that really hurt my head. Actually, it's kind of deja vu. I had a dream about that like a month ago, so it was really weird.
Well, let's hope you can dream after that hit and you don't have a concussion.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks very much, Kevin Federick.
Super game by Kevin Federick today, and I'll tell you, he was really sandwiched there with Whitworth and O'Boyle getting to him on that occasion, thus resulting in the six stitches. But the Cougars prevail 49-39 over Tulsa in this contest. Tulsa was down early 21-0, and the Golden Hurricane came back, but it was never really enough. BYU always able to keep a little bit of distance between themselves and Tulsa. BYU wins this one in Provo. We'll be back with much more after this.
BYU sports broadcasts are made possible by the BYU Athletic Department and by the BYU Cougar Club. Champions supporting champions at Brigham Young University.
BYU Sports are made possible by contributing members of KBYU and by Granite Furniture Superstores, providing floor coverings including carpet, vinyl, and hardwood flooring for over 85 years. And by Losey Jewelers, serving Utah for almost half a century. Losey Jewelers features rings, settings, diamonds, and other precious gems, exclusively located in Cotton Tree Square, Provo. And by Tri-City Ford and American Fork, featuring a wide selection of Ford cars and trucks, as well as service departments from its new location just off I-15 in American Fork.
100 years ago, it was gunslingers, miners, and settlers. A typical frontier town. Now, something's happening in this old ghost town. Ruby, Arizona is putting the wildlife back in the Wild West. See how Mother Nature's taking over from the ghosts of Ruby next time on Nature.
Nature, next on KBYU.
KBYU and the BBC capture the pioneer spirit in Wagon Train, Journey of the Modern Pioneers, Friday, November 21st at 7 p.m.
Nature is made possible by viewers like you and by the Masonic Foundation, supporting the continuing search for truth. Freemasonry, a worldwide fraternal order dedicated to the improvement of our society through practice of friendship, moral living, and brotherly love. And by Central Bank, established in 1891 and serving Utah County for over 100 years. Central Bank, locally owned and managed with 8 locations.
We now join the following program in progress.